One of my favorite statistics about climate change is that apparently 60% of Americans reckon that climate change has become like a religion, quote, used to control people. Now, you've got to wonder, why do they think that? It's not as though that they have a deep understanding of, you know, climate science or the uncertainty of the models, or even that the past periods, say the Egyptian periods, was a lot hotter than it is now. No, the reason that they think that is because they actually smell a rat.
Yes, I can definitely smell shit.
And one of the biggest, smelliest, hairiest, rotten rats of them all in climate science is the way that so many ridiculous things are now attributed to climate science, and I've got a good list of them here. Now, I was spurred to make this video because I saw just the other day that apparently some sort of sleep disorders are now caused by climate change, and this is obviously a disaster. So I thought I'd do half an hour of Googling and find some other things which are really rather funny impacts, supposedly, of climate change. So let's start. Apparently, the flavour of gin and tonic could be impacted by climate change, study finds, according to The Guardian. Apparently, the juniper berries, apparently in hot climates, they taste a little bit different, and that's going to be a bit of a disaster. Now, I mean, look, the ice caps are going to melt, a billion people are going to die, Bangladesh is going to be flooded. Who the heck cares about the flavour of gin and tonics?
We've run out of tonic.
Run out of tonic? But that's not terrible, that's catastrophic.
Yeah, okay, bad example. Let's try another one. The climate crisis could lead to a banana crisis. Major banana exporters could face 60% drop in growing area due to warming. Look, I'm sorry, but I don't actually believe that. I mean, we're in a banana growing area up here in North Queensland. And it's noticeable that in the last 50 years, banana growing has gone up from gone from New South Wales, where it's cold, up to here in the tropics. And it can get a lot warmer than where we are here. And you can still grow bananas. Take it from me. I used to pick bananas when I was a student. The next one. Satellite orbits are going to change and space junk is going to move faster because the top of the atmosphere is going to be slightly different. And of course, this is a disaster and we're going to need more study for the scientists to better understand how the changes brought by increasing CO2 are going to affect the movement of satellites. I'm sure they'll be able to work it out.
Copy that, Gibson.
Explorer, this is Kowalski confirming visual contact.
Houston, we have a problem.
This is the one that I mentioned previously, and this is in one of the top journals, right? If you get into one of the top journals, in this case, Nature Communications, the scientists, you know, they'll probably get a promotion just on that and the ability to get more funding. So sleep apnea, global warming may increase the burden of obstructive sleep apnea. Now, I'm sure that's right, that, you know, it's hard to sleep in a hot night. But it's also hard to sleep when you're freezing cold, and there's a whole lot of people that die of freezing cold, but we don't hear about the sleep disorders or problems from them. Now, while I was looking for some of these things, I came across this interesting article about basically how climate lies need to be criminalized. Climate misinformation turning crisis into a catastrophe, report says. They're basically saying people like me who reckon that gin and tonic changing flavour might not be a particular disaster, or that maybe there isn't going to be a banana crisis because actually you're going to be able to grow bananas on the North Pole because it'll be so warm there. Well, sorry, I've got to go to jail for that. This is a beauty. Shark attacks. They're going to get worse. Of course they're going to get worse. Now you think, oh, this is because it's getting hot. All the sharks are going to move into Northern Europe and up into Canada or somewhere. And that's true, of course. But it's also because people are going to be so hot from climate change, more people are going to go swimming in the sea where they're going to be eaten by sharks. Another really important one here. There's going to be a chili shortage. The sriracha shortage is warning about the climate crisis. And then we have in Puerto Rico, some sort of frog. The croaks are going to now be of a higher pitch due to global heating. I mean, you just sort of wonder, What was this this scientist actually thinking when they were doing this research? Even more important, goats are shrinking. Turns out that the alpine chamois mountain goat in Italy is now 25% smaller on average than in the 1980s. So it's not actually shrinking, but they are getting smaller. And interestingly, the National Geographic seems to have got themselves into a fairly typical knot where they say goat populations may also change as lighter goats are more likely to freeze to death in cold winters. So the way it works like this is because it's getting hotter, goats are now not growing as big. And because they're not growing as big, they're more susceptible to cold. So they're all going to freeze to death in the winter. So the warming climate is going to make them freeze to death. This is a serious one. Apparently the children's IQ and brain development is going to be badly affected. In fact, I quote, "This is nothing short of a public health emergency." And of course it is, but not for the reasons. What these people have done to the children is scared the living daylights out of them. So they all think they're going to die in 20 years' time because the earth is going to boil. It's not because of the little bit of increased heat. If it was increased heat, me living in the tropics, I should have my brain completely frazzled by now. Yeah, okay, let's move on. We're going to have bumpier air flights. Now, of course, if you're the sort of the jet set with your private jet flying around the world telling everybody else how that they've got to cut their carbon footprint, this is probably a big problem because it's true in a warmer climate there should be more turbulence, and up to three times apparently in the next decade. But again, you know, as I said before, if we're going to all burn to hell and the Bangladesh is going to be flooded, are we really worried about an increased turbulence? Now, this is an example where I think we need more climate change, because apparently Australian lakes are turning pink. Climate change could turn more salt lakes pink in Western Australia. And in fact, when I look at these lakes, I think I want more pink lakes. These are seriously cool lakes, and we want more like this. Ah, blood under pressure, how climate change threatens blood safety and supply chains. Apparently, extreme weather events, vector-borne diseases, which of course are caused by climate change, and temperature fluctuation can disrupt blood collection, testing and transport and storage, threatening both the safety and sufficiency of blood products. So look, in 20 years' time, if you cut your toe, no blood transfusion for you, because we just won't be able to collect blood then. Another one on mental health, how heat waves can wreak havoc on your mental health. Well, look, they're right. There has been a problem with mental health due to climate change, but it's the reporting and the exaggeration and the catastrophization of it that is the real problem, not the actual heat itself. Look, people get very depressed in cold, dreary climates. Go to the north of Scotland, go to Wales, where I was for a while. You want to cut your throat after a little while because you just want to see a little bit of sun and get a little bit of warmth. So it's not like that, you know, heat is the only thing that causes mental health problems. Shooing away more flies than usual? Climate change could be boosting fly numbers. Yeah, right. All right, you'll like this one. Baseball home runs are going to be 10% more likely. This is an article in the Bulletin of the American Meteorological Society, a very prestigious organization. And look, I thought that this was some sort of, you know, some sort of spoof they were having a lend to me, but I don't think they are. So what they're saying is that because the air is a little bit warmer, it's less dense, and therefore a baseball or a cricket ball for that matter will go a little further and you'll get more home runs. Not that I think 10% more home runs is really a problem, but I think they're serious. They say adaptations such as building domes on stadiums or shifting day games to night games reduce temperature effects on America's pastime. Our results highlight the myriad ways that a warmer planet restructures our lives, livelihoods, and recreations, some quantifiable and easily adapted to, as shown here. Yes, it is actually pretty easy to adapt. You don't put a dome on your stadium. You just make your bat a little bit lighter, or you make your ball a little bit heavier, or maybe you just live with a few more home runs. This must be some sort of metaphor for how if there's going to be climate change, and I don't think there's going to be anything worrying, but if there is, then you're better off adapting to it because it's cheaper than turning off the fossil fuel supply, which has been so important in improving our lives, rather than, you know, doing some of these silly things. Look, you may well have other examples of some silly effects where climates are clearly trying much too hard for some unknown reasons and just making themselves look like gooses. If you do, put a comment below. Now, when it comes to gooses, real gooses, otherwise known as geese, apparently they're badly affected too. Global heating, geese shifts migrations, stop off northwards. Well, what a surprise, they're affected. And actually, when I did this, it struck me, let me try almost any animal, typing in the word to Google, climate change followed by animals. So I did climate change elephant, and you'll be surprised to know that climate change is a significant threat to elephants. So I did climate change kangaroo. Climate change is impacting kangaroos in various ways, including changing their habitat, food availability, and overall health. They didn't mention whether the kangaroo's mental health is affected, but I'm pretty sure it is. Climate change chameleon. Yes, chameleons. Global warming poses significant threats. Climate change giraffes. Rare giraffes in Kenya face extinction because of poaching and climate change. Oh, yes. Climate change albatross. Climate crisis pushes albatross divorce rates higher. Albatrosses form a monogamous relationship, but apparently, and this is in the Royal Society, for goodness sake, you know, Isaac Newton. They pushed, I can barely believe this, right? Apparently, albatrosses are splitting up more often. All right, climate change gorilla. Yep. Climate change is making endangered mountain gorillas more thirsty. Now, look, I thought, I can see an adaptation here. But we have this problem with the gin and tonics. And what we can do is the gin and tonic, which we can't now sell because it tastes a little bit different due to climate change, we can give to the mountain gorillas because they won't notice because they're so thirsty they'll drink just about anything. Problem solved. Two problems solved in one go. Well, look, you got to ask, well, why is this happening? Why are doubtless some perfectly sensible scientists forced into doing some things which really, you know, it just makes them look a bit silly. And actually, it's turning people off. People are looking at this and thinking, why is it there's nothing good about climate change? And some of these things are just really completely crazy. What is actually happening here is that people are seeing through what's happening and that they're trusting science less and less, which is a bad thing in a way, but it's a good thing because until the science institutions get their act together, especially on climate change and the other big issues of our time, unfortunately, this lack of trust in science is pretty well inevitable. And as you've seen in a lot of my videos, this is something that I've been trying to do something about because we need to make the scientific institutions reliable again. I'm sounding like somebody there. Thanks very much.